We are talking frictional forces today. Frictional forces exist when objects in contact have relative motions or attempted relative motions. Consider what happens when I push this desk. If the force I apply is small, the desk doesn't move. It's a frictional force exerted by the ground on the desk that balances my force and keeps the desk stationary. This frictional force is called a static friction force because the desk is static. If I push the desk hard enough, the desk moves. While the desk moves, there is a frictional force resisting the motion. In that case, the friction force is called a kinetic friction force. Let's first investigate static friction forces. Now I want to draw a free body diagram of my desk. Let me simplify the desk as a square on the ground. We know there is always the weight of the object, which we can call W, pointing downward here, and there is a normal force exerted by the ground to support the desk. Let's call it N. Now, if I apply a horizontal force, which I call F applied, since the desk doesn't move, according to Newton's first law, we know there must be another force that balances this force I apply. That's the static friction force we are talking about. Static friction force appears near the surfaces in contact. So let me draw the static friction force here at the bottom of the desk. Usually, we use a lowercase f with a subscript s to represent the static friction force. What Newton's first law tells us is the magnitude of the static friction force is equal to the magnitude of the force I apply. And also, the directions of them are opposite. As we can imagine, I can change the force I apply as I want. When I change the force I apply, the magnitude of the static friction force must also change. In general, the magnitude of the static friction force depends on the other forces exerted on the object. Its direction is always opposite to the direction of the attempted motion, which would have been produced by the other force. We also notice there is a maximum static friction force. When the force I apply exceeds the maximum value, the desk moves. People have been studying the factors that affect the maximum static friction force. In many cases, actually in all the cases we care in our class, the maximum static friction force is proportional to the magnitude of the normal force. The relation is usually written as Fs maximum. Let me use Fs maximum to represent the maximum static friction force. Its magnitude is equal to some constant mu with a subscript s times the magnitude of the normal force. This constant mu s is called the coefficient of static friction. It varies with materials, but is independent of the things such as the shape of the object or the area of surfaces in contact. So now, what can we do with this elegant empirical law of the maximum static friction? Well, in many cases, we need to keep objects static. With the knowledge of maximum static friction, we can deduce constraints or design structures, proper structures, so that the object can be kept static and stable. Here I have some examples to show you. picture, the first picture shows a block sitting at rest on an incline. If we want the block to be stationary on the incline, then the coefficient of static friction between the block and the incline tells us the maximum angle of the incline we can have. In the second picture, imagine this simple line is a ladder leaning against a wall. Our experience tells us if the angle between the ladder and the ground is too small, it would be dangerous to climb on the ladder. Again, the safe positions of the ladder are closely related to the coefficient of static friction here. In the last picture, supposing we have a bus which is accelerating, and there is a suitcase on the ground of the bus. If we don't want the suitcase to slide, the acceleration of the bus cannot exceed a certain value. This limit is again decided by the coefficient of static friction between the suitcase and the ground of the bus. You will already find problems similar as the first and the last one in your homework this week. For the question like the second one, we'll deal with it after we learn how to apply Newton's laws to rotational motion. Now let's take a quick summary about static friction. Static friction appears when there is an attempted relative motion. It can adjust itself to balance the other forces, but the adjustment has a limit. The limit is the maximum static friction force. Any actual static friction force is always in between zero and the maximum static friction force. And the maximum static friction force itself only depends on the coefficient of static friction and the magnitude of the normal force. As for the direction of a static friction force, it's always perpendicular to the normal force and opposite to the attempted motion which would have been caused by the other forces exerted on the object. Finally, we can ascribe the existence of static friction forces to surface roughness. The fundamental origin is electromagnetic force between atoms and or molecules near the surfaces in contact. It's just the same as the macroscopic origin of normal forces. Before we move on to kinetic friction, let's do a quiz here. Here are two questions. In the first one, we have a block A sitting on top of block B. And suppose I apply a horizontal force on block B, but both block A and block B don't move. Now, please draw all the static friction forces on block B and also block A. In the second question, we have an incline B sitting on a board C, and there is a block A sliding down on the incline. This is A, this is B, and this is C. Okay. Now let's assume there is no friction between A and B, and also both B and C are stationary. The question is, does the board C exert any static friction on the incline B? If it does, what's the direction of the static friction? You have 2 minutes. I'll collect your